I'm Raphael Apfeldorfer, Advanced Technology Director at Actility. And today I'd like to share Actility's views on how device onboarding is currently made on LoRaWAN networks, what the challenges the ecosystem meets, and how hosting port activation helps simplify the business process and increase overall network and data security. First, today we have to realize each party meets very specific challenges when they do mass provisioning of large fleets of LoRaWAN devices. As device owners, people need to ensure the security of the sensors data up to the application platform, making sure that nobody can actually access their data and benefit also from easy activation on as many LoRaWAN networks as they can. And for device manufacturers, what they really need is also a generic manufacturing process so they can deploy a personalization that is independent of network operators and ensuring security secrets are only shared with necessary parties. And as LoRaWAN service providers, they need a way to onboard as many devices for their wide portfolio as they can and ensure the right level of security according to user expectation and use cases, especially in the context of global roaming. So let's dive a bit in the LoRaWAN security overview first. So as you know, LoRaWAN is a very secure system. It provides all the security built in, the data confidentiality to the application session key encryption of the data from device to the cloud, the data integrity and authenticity. So LoRaWAN frames are all secured with message integrity codes and they are encrypting using the network session key. And finally, defense against replay protection mechanisms, such as the monotonic frame counts for the join procedure and also the data exchanges. But even if the security is built in into the network, some of the processes are still left out of bounds, especially during the provisioning steps. The first one is the key injection. So at the time of manufacturing, we need to provision the device with that key and network key for the LoRaWAN 1.1 standard. And this key injection is most of the time done in the factory when you personalize the device, unless you share the secrets with more players outside of the factory in some other systems. The second step is the key sharing. So once the key has been injected into the device, it also needs to be shared with the network because we're running on symmetric cryptography algorithms. So the keys must be shared, pre-shared between device and cloud for end-to-end security. Most of the time, the key sharing is done to key management platforms or directly to the joint server itself. So different players on the cloud side may receive the keys and need to store them directly and securely, and also use them securely. And sometimes this step is also done involving more players, obviously weakening security. And the third step is the key distribution at the time of activation. So that part is not more part of the provisioning, but is also a key step for the security. And this is partly covered by the LoRaWAN backend interface standard that specifies how the session key is derived by the join server may be shared with network server and application server on the cloud platform side. So for a device to get from the factory to the network securely and being activated on the network, there are three big steps. The first one is this device personalization in the factory. So most of the time it involves this device maker personalizing by injecting keys into the device, but also some identifiers like the dev UI and app UI in LoRaWAN 1.0 or called join UI in 1.1. We'll come back to this. And then ideally, at the time of when you inject the key into the device, you manage to inject them on the cloud side with as few players as possible involved and as few steps as possible. And finally, for the device maker to have large batches of devices, it's much easier if they can make a generic personalization that is not dependent on the next steps. So they have to select this API UI, that is the important identifier we will see later in the presentation. In the second step, the device is commissioned, meaning that it has been sold to the customer. And the customers also selected the connectivity plan from one of the connectivity providers and has associated the device to his subscriber account in this connectivity provider platform. So here, that's the time where it goes with a mobile network operator most of the time, or it can be also enterprise networks. But you associate your device with a subscriber ID and different profiles for device, connectivity, routing. And in the third step, when the device is activated, meaning it's turned on the network, then the device will perform the join procedure. But that procedure can happen both on the home network directly, but also in roaming now, away from the home network. In that procedure, we derive more keys. But the main problem we need to solve now for activation are these two challenges. How to share the keys with the join server that is going to use them with minimum exposure to different players. And the second one is how to personalize device so it points to the correct join server at the time where the join procedure arrives. How do we target this specific join server on which you have onboarded the key? So the first challenge, the app key sharing challenge, it can be very complex because sometimes the device is not directly sold directly from a manufacturer to an end user, but it actually goes through a very complex chain of custodians for the device. So the first thing to consider is that your device may be composed of subsystems, modules, or even secure elements on the module or on the device itself directly. And all of these people may take part to the key injection ceremony in which you inject key into secure elements, key inside the module, or key inside the device directly. So all of them are potential key holders we need to consider when we perform activation. But even after this, you have a different chain of custodians with distributors who are warehouse, resellers, retailers, system integrators, which are the domain specialists providing installation and support using the products, and the network operator itself that can also be for the B2C an important player in installing the devices for large enterprises. And finally, of course, the end user, the company, or the person using the product and service. And what you don't want is that all of these players get access to the keys, because obviously that's going to weaken security. And sharing that, and if you have to do so, then you have to share this securely. And of course, this is a hassle for scalability. Everybody needs to be in a secure process. So the optimal flow is when the potential key holders are actually directly sharing the key into a joint server, and this is where we will introduce sync park activation. So how is this done today? So today, you have most often the keys are shared between all of these people in the custody chain, unfortunately, and that's really why we have introduced a new product. Sometimes, worst case, it's directly written on the device, on old paper that or the boxes that goes with the device. Obviously, that's the lower security you can expect. Anybody can access directly the keys that are going to secure the communication. And it's also extremely complex to scale because copying the app key inside a joint server may be error prone. For mass provisioning, most of the time people are actually using small databases or Excel files, like encrypting CSV. So obviously the data is a little bit more secure, it doesn't belong to the chain, but of course that's as good as you trust Microsoft Excel for security. And also then you have web services and storage, but that's also adding another part in the chain, another price, and so the cost of securing this additional server. And of course, also, you need to connect all of the different services together so they interact, they have the proper account set up. So it's also additional hassle during provisioning steps. Coming to the second challenge, the API UI selection challenge. So let's study how the API UI personalization should be done and what are the possible caveats. So first, your device is actually associated with a number of network elements. The application server, network server, joint server, and all of them may be run by a different supplier. So most of the time, MNOs and large corporations, they own network servers and joint servers, possibly also application servers into application enablement platforms. But in the different use cases we meet, when we see deployments of LoRaWAN networks, we see that sometimes different players are playing different roles. Of course, for the device manufacturer, they need a generic process. And when they manufacture, they want to know already what's going to be the security partner they have to choose. And also the different players are selected potentially by different people. So this device manufacturer will select security player, but this could most likely the end user or the company running the products that is going to select the connectivity supplier. And then the application supplier depends more on which type of IoT application you're running, whether you only have one on your device or you may have multiple. But most of the time today, this is selected by the device manufacturer. So when storing the secrets after manufacturing, you're sharing them with the security player. And this security player needs to be referenced by the device. When you do the personalization, you put this API UI, and that's the real reference to the security player. So that's the time where you select your joint server. And that must be done at time of personalization when you enter the API UI directly in the device. The API UI is absolutely not identifying an application or an application server. There might have been some confusions previously in the past. It has been really clarified after the early LoRaWAN releases. But it is the identifier of the joint server. And not assigning a unique joint server to a particular joint UI will really cause problem when we come to roaming. So why? So this API UI and joint server binding, this is really absolutely critical when you do activation away from home. So until now, there are many devices that have been sold in the field and are still being sold, and they have arbitrary joint UIs, so API UI. I say that the one is 1.0 naming, the one is 1.1 naming, but I talk about them interchangeably. And so we've always been doing up to now mostly activation at home, and so selecting arbitrary API UI hasn't been really a problem. So devices are joining with an arbitrary API UI, you just route it to your home server, and to the home joint server connected to your home server, network server. It hasn't been a big problem, but now we are seeing many more networks starting to roam with each other. And when activation away from home becomes really important, then we meet the following problem. The device is not provisioned for both passive roaming and handover roaming. The device is not provisioned on the visited network. That's the principle. Device come on a network, the network doesn't know about the device, so it has to search for who is the home network for this device. And that's using the API UI identifier that it will be able to query a particular joint server about the home network server. Of course, you must have business agreements between visited network server, home network server, and this joint server. And these business agreements will allow the visited network server to query joint server, but only based on the fact that it has API UI. And if it does not associate a unique joint server to an API UI, it will not be able to perform these queries, not be able to translate a joint UI into a particular joint server and in turn into a particular home network server. And basically, the activation away from home for any type of roaming will just not work. So after you selected your API UI, you want to associate it with a joint server. So what are the different joint server supplier types? So the predominant type today is the connectivity supplier, taking both roles, connectivity and security, and allowing all the devices that you bought on their premises to join their networks. If you want the API UI to be associated to a particular connectivity supplier, it means you associate API UI with your connectivity. So every time you have different connectivity for device manufacturer, it means you have a different batch of devices with a different batch of API UIs, each referencing the different connectivity supplier. So that's one possible case, but it requires either large batches or repersonalization to change the API UI. The second type of suppliers are the pure security suppliers, people coming from the cellular world, Most of the time, they have a trusted key manager. We're calling them trusted key managers. Most of the time, they have dedicated hardware linked to them, like secure elements. And then they make the link between secure elements on the device and their platforms, which is really helpful for the activation, but also requires that we interconnect the system with all of the different connectivity suppliers so that it works. So that's one big work that you need to undertake when you use this type of suppliers. And you need to have this activation agreement set up between their platforms, if they run a joint server, and your network server. And then the third type of suppliers that we want to introduce are suppliers that are more dealing with the interconnection of networks, such as Actility, who's providing a sync park exchange platform to interconnect different networks together. And using this interconnectivity, we want to enable the system to massively scale the number of devices that can roam on the system or have global connectivity. And introducing a central piece for the activation service in this system will allow all devices to easily join the network from anywhere they join. So that system will allow also to deal with this arbitrary API UI allocation we have to deal with. A lot of legacy devices have not actually selected API UIs that are referencing a joint server. The one way of dealing with these devices is to configure the visited and home network servers to use their internal JS for everything they do at home. This we don't need to touch, it works. And then for anything they don't know, so presumably roaming devices, we route them to a central joint server. This way, all devices continue the same way, continue to activate the same way as before when they're at home, but when they are roaming, and we don't know where to route them because they have arbitrary API UIs, not referencing a single joint server, we can route them to the sync park activation service. And if we have provisioned them inside the service, then they'll be able to join. And the visiting network will discover the home network and activate the device away from home. So this way, we can enable global roaming to become reality even with arbitrary API UI devices. So now I'd like to dive a bit into how the activation service works. So basically you have three big steps. The device manufacturer will pre-commission in the service, meaning that it will import their app keys into the service. And in turn, the service gives back some ownership token that the device manufacturer will need to pass in an out-of-band process to its subscribers so they can claim the device itself. This is a one-off ownership token, so the same device cannot be claimed twice. And what we advise for transporting this type of information is the usage of QR codes, for instance. That could be an easy way to transport this one-off token from device manufacturer to subscribers, but we have a presentation about this later. And in the third step, of course, you activate your device on the network. Actility is going to interconnect this activation service with all the major network server suppliers, and so enable this activation away from home. To ease the onboarding, we have also partners with all of the major secure element suppliers that are working in the LoRaWAN world. So today we have already announced in the press relationship with STMicro, with the ST Safe Secure Element, and IDEMIA. And we're working with them to facilitate the onboarding of app keys onto the platform. So first, of course, they are facilitators for security. They have very strong security background, and the usage of secure elements will allow secure storage of app keys on the device, as well as what we do on the network. The derivation of app key without the MCU protocol stack knowing, so we have proper security that can be spied upon. And then the device manufacturer will not need to generate and distribute the app keys. Even when they integrate with sync park activation, we will have done that already at the secure element level with the secure element partners. And if the secure elements hold not only app key, but also dev UI and join UI, you can imagine you have flows where you don't even have LoRaWAN personalization at all on the device premise, on the device maker premises. That simply need to solder the secure elements, and all of the activation parties taken care of for them. So sometimes the cost of secure elements can be offset by just looking at the total cost of what it would need to repersonalize your device or to onboard it securely up to the subscriber and sharing that securely among the different custodians. So that's one of the use cases where usage of secure elements coupled with an activation service can really save you money instead of increasing the book cost. Finally, the activation is of course, the SYNC Park activation service is of course secured with on the cloud side as well. We're using hardware security modules delivered by UTMACO, the SC52. So we have a couple of them to ensure the high availability and geographical redundancy. And we share the cost of these hardware appliances by running a SaaS service, SYNC Park activation as a SaaS service. Then your app keys are fully secured because they never transit in clear into any part of the system. They're always encrypted with some keys that are bound to the hardware security module. And of course, we support LoRaWAN 1.0 and 1.1 devices. And when we partner with Secure Element on the device side, the secrets are shared between Secure Element directly with the HSM. So you have only hardware tamper-proof resistant PCs that are holding the keys, and it's never shared outside of this hardware tamper-proof element. So SYNC Park activation belongs to the Actility ecosystem. We are already powering a lot of national rollouts through our SYNC Park wireless suite, and also now targeting many large manufacturers and vertical players with the SYNC Park Enterprise product. And all of them are going to be interconnected through the SYNC Park Exchange platform. And through the SYNC Park activation, we solve this API UI selection and app key sharing challenge. If you want to know more about this interconnection and SYNC Park Exchange, we have also another webinar that happened and is already available on the YouTube link indicated at the bottom of the screen. So this is the Actility Advanced Roaming Hub, allowing the interconnectivity of all the LoRaWAN systems together. And finally, I haven't talked about the SYNC Park X suite that is connecting all of these systems with the application enablement platforms to a whole suite of data transformation and exposure products. So the value proposal for SYNC Park activation service is really to get truly generic devices for the device makers, and truly generic that works with all of the major network operators, since Actility manages the operator service agreements as well as the manufacturer service agreements. So the expectation is we have reduced operational costs, no need to secure these keys, no need to have complex provisioning procedures, and we can focus on connectivity and leave a trusted service that care about all the security aspects. And this is ensured, of course, by this secure element and HSM options. And finally, of course, through our roaming services, we provide future-proof services, global connectivity, and we support LoRaWAN 1.1 and coming Alliance item as they come. So to conclude the session, I wanted to show you also how this can be integrated when you're an MNO or an enterprise. We have made a demo application that runs on iOS called the Pineapple Support Platform. So that's a small demo app that scans owner tokens and provision the device on SYNC Park activation, SYNC Park wireless, and your application server all at the time with the same QR code. So basically it runs like this. You start the application on your iOS phone. Previously, the pre-commission has already been done by the device maker. So you select your account that is going to put your account on activation, wireless, and application server. The application connects to the different systems, retrieve your devices that are already provisioned. So by clicking the plus, you can just scan the QR code rapidly with the application. the main information specific to the device are displayed. And then when you press activate, the application takes care about calling all the different APIs for JS provisioning, home NS provisioning, and also possibly the application server provisioning. Then your tracker is ready and can be activated on the network. It will join, and all the provisioning parameters have been done without any key sharing involved because of this pre-commissioning step where we have the owner token replacing the app. So if you want to know more about the SIGPA activation service, of course, I encourage you to contact your Actility sales representative. Also, we are going to share the video of the webinar shortly on the Actility website to you again. And the slides will be available through SlideShare on the Actility LinkedIn account. So I'd like to thank you for attending. Please don't hesitate to share the video or slides with your colleagues. And know we are ready to receive Q&As if you have any questions on the service. Thank you. So we received one question, whether it's possible to have some white papers, guides, or to describe the subject. So of course, we will make the slide decks available and the slide share. But if you contact our pre-sales representative also, we can give you more detailed presentation about the service. Of course, this is not meant to be a complete presentation of the service, just an overview. We are also going to publish guides and so on for people who are going to engage proof of concepts with these systems.